Hi, this is Decentered Media, conversations about community-focused communications for positive social change. Hello, Rob Watson here for Decentered Media, and this is a quick update about this week's community media discussion, which takes place on Thursdays from 6 p.m. And you can get access to the conversation and the discussion each week if you join us via Patreon. So go to patreon.com/decenteredmedia and we'll send you the link to access the Zoom session. You can also check out decentered.co.uk, where I've got a number of post regular blogs and updates about community media related issues. And I'm on Twitter and Instagram at Decentered Media. This week in our conversation, I want to talk about the role of storytelling and community storytelling, particularly as a way of supporting and enhancing community development and community engagement. And one of the things that kind of looking at and have been doing some work on is about public engagement. And typically in a public engagement setting that uses media and follows the marketing, mass media, press and public relations style approach, what's really focused on is if you like, is the number of likes or hits or the total number of listeners or viewers that a piece of media gets, or how much it's shared. And it's kind of about the numbers, and you know, we look at levels of engagement by the kind of response that it gets, that we can count the metrics, and that's, you know, valuable insight that we get from that. But I think it kind of, it doesn't tell us the whole story. And there's an element which is missing from that, which is how and in what way do we find our experience of community and our personal, interpersonal and extra personal experience of what's going on in our lives within our communities, how do we find that meaningful? And what the way we've always done this is, you know, kind of civilized beings ever since we, you know, society is built through this, is by telling stories and by sharing and circulating stories. And stories work on a number of levels. On one level, stories can be an account where you kind of detail and list a sequence, series of events, a plot, a set of actions. It can be a way of looking at characters and the interplay of characters and the, if you like, the needs and the stances that those characters take and what they have to deal with. And then thirdly, you can look at it in a more mythological approach, which is about the way in which stories keep resonating and that they play out certain archetypal roles. So we want to think about storytelling not just within any one of those specific frameworks, but thinking about it in terms of the interaction between those different ways that we make sense and that we find things meaningful. Some of us will focus more on the concrete, the facts and figures, if you like, that are expressed in a story. Some people will be looking at relationships and interpersonal relationships that are expressed in a story, and others will be looking at the wider resonance of the themes of those stories. And it's not to say that any one of them is right, but if we only stick with one of them and we don't have an appreciation of the other elements within this dynamic, then we're missing what the power is of storytelling. And I kind of feel that in community development work, and it will be interesting to listen and hear other people's experience in our discussion about this week, is, you know, focusing on just the account, if you like, that is given, doesn't seem enough. You know, we're not particularly satisfied about the quality of our community interaction. We might be able to, you know, explain and account for the numbers of interactions that we have, but that doesn't tell us anything about whether those interactions are meaningful or whether they're useful or how they're changing or what it takes to put them there in the first place, and what we value from them and what we maybe reject from them as well. So, you know, this idea of meaningfulness is essential to the notion of community, of any kind of storytelling. But it's also, I think, one of the things that's changed in more recent times, or certainly in the work that I do through community media, that I think needs to be more recognised, is that there's a democratisation of the role of people within that storytelling process. So, I mean, this is my analogy, because I'm watching it at the moment, but and it's a bit geeky. But Star Wars started with an archetypal story with a hero and a villain. And that's really all it kind of did. It had a couple of people who, you know, followed that Joseph Campbell model of the hero's journey, and a couple of figures that were, you know, kind of along the way were helpers and guides and that kind of thing. And it fit within that kind of format of mythological fairy tale fantasy storytelling, and it struck a chord. You know, it became massively successful, and spawned a huge load of other programs and films and toys that followed on from it. Created a space of imagination, but it was semi removed from our real experience. It isn't anything like what we encounter here. It was a fantasy set far, far away. However, if you look at the way that some of the Star Wars story has shifted and changed, at the moment I'm watching the Andor series on Disney, and that follows it's a kind of prequel series to the film Rogue One, and what that film set up was the fact that Luke Skywalker didn't just act independently and alone. He wasn't this force, to use a word, that was... He was the antagonist that was there at the right moment, and he had these gifts that he used and he tapped into, and he was guided into that by his, you know, kind of advisor. But he was also part of an infrastructure that put the rebellion together, that had brought all these people together, that financed the rebellion, that needed building blocks. It wasn't just him acting alone. He had to act on the basis that he'd been given a platform by many other people. So there's a phrase that Robert Keegan uses, which he says, we're not individuals as such, we are embeduals, in which means that we are part of a wider society, and that we're part of a broader mutual engagement between other people, and that we get to act individually, but we're also, you know, constantly aware that we're also part of a culture, of a civilization, of mutual support and mutual benefit. So that story, if you like, shifts from it being one about the heroic individual to one where the guardians and the sentinels and the carers and the people who look after the mechanics and the nurses and the people who train the pilots to go up in there, they're not given their recognition in the initial story. It's kind of assumed that they're just the background. But now it looks like more focus is being given to the other individuals involved, the infrastructure that is needed to foster a rebellion against an evil empire. And it's not just about somebody acting alone and by themselves. Now, on that level, our stories are kind of quite archetypal. And it plays out with something like Star Wars because it is an archetypal model. But in our community approach, you know, often we don't get recognition for the small, the interpersonal guidance and relationships and reciprocation that we need to build up to sustain a culture and a community. You can't just come in as a, you know, and this is often what is put forward in our politics, is that we need a strong leader to come in and, you know, take us out of the wilderness, you know, a messiah figure almost. And that's quite problematic, because fundamentally, if we're not capable of building and sustain a society and a civilization ourselves, you know, it won't endure and it won't last. We have to do the work on the basis of that, you know, embedded level of relationships. But those stories don't get told, and yet they're really essential to building communities. So think of it like a tapestry, and a tapestry is composed of millions of threads, different colors, different textures, and they weave and interrelate along different routes and patterns, and they form different pictures, and we are just one of those threads within a tapestry. And we you know, we maybe step back occasionally and see the bigger picture, but that's quite difficult to do. But also, we don't really sometimes pay enough attention to how it's held together and how it is, you know, these stories are... Sorry, my video stopped for a second. So here we go again. So we don't often step back enough from the tapestry. We just see, you know, we see the bigger picture then, but what we don't take account of is the skill, patience, the care, the artistry that was put into making and bringing that picture together. So what's our role that we play as individuals? What is it we do in order to be able to facilitate and to develop that, those stories? And so community media for me is something where we don't try and do this from the top down. We don't want this to be like an industrialized process. It's more of a, I suppose, a craft process where other people can get involved and do things which don't have to be technically proficient. You don't have to be the best. You don't have to be Ian McKellen, or, you know, you don't have to be, you know, a great orator to tell a story, Alec Guinness, Richard Burton, those kind of figures. But you can be somebody who is able to articulate and share their experience, because we each have a story that we would like to tell and that we would like to be heard. And, you know, kind of people like Carl Jung and Marie-Louise von France, they really tell us how important stories are, both on a collective level and in a personal level as a psychological resonance. Stories tell us something about our own development as well, and the way that we deal with challenges, and that way we imagine the possibilities of the future. Because without stories, we don't know where it creates, if you like, an imaginative space where we can test the boundaries and we can identify with. And one of the things that Carl Jung talks about is the idea that modern Western people are in search of a myth to live, as in search of a story to live. We've told ourselves that we are articulators of our own destiny. Is that, you know, the Promethean myth, that we are able to create and manifest our own future. And what that does is that takes us away from the fact that that's not how we bring about our future, is that we actually articulate our future in different ways, and different civilizations and different cultures do things in different ways as well. But there's an interrelationship between those, and deeper we go, there are kind of core stories, you know, good versus evil, you know, the scaling the mountaintop and descending to the caves. They're part of the dynamic of the way that we think about the world, the differences between the world that exists on the land and in the sea. You know, we can formulate the void and the chaos and the civilization that we have. You know, we formulate our story around these archetypal themes and patterns, the light and the dark, which become a kind of rule of thumb, which we take for granted because they're an essential part of who we are. And they keep getting told. These stories keep getting repeated. It's kind of endlessly repeated almost. And we have the heroes, you know, the Joseph Campbell and the hero's journey is constantly repeated in Western culture. Although there are variations now, as I've kind of indicated, that, you know, don't just identify with the heroic figure in the same way that we may be used to, or try to compensate for. One of the things that Jung talks about is that often what is expressed in our dreams and our fantasies is a compensation for what we lack. And that we use stories in a dreamlike way in order to be able to satisfy a need and to satisfy something which is out of balance. And so our stories are a creative way of engaging with other people and ourselves to become whole and complete. So the stories can serve a very creative, viable function. It's not just about detailing facts and figures and information. It's about offering identifying a transformational approach, moment. It's about saying what transforms us, what inspires us to move to the next level, to become better, to grow, either individually or collectively. How do we bring all of these threads together and become something more than the sum of our parts, and we transform into something new? Well, rather than a kind of dialectical approach where it's a clash of opposites and the history is a class warfare, or a kind of the workers versus finance, those kind of grand narratives, this is more about interpersonal transformation and about a sense of emerging consciousness that comes out of what we recognize when we track and trace stories, how they've developed over time. Is that how we see how things have changed? We are no longer subject. Well, it's a cliche to say this, but people in the West don't think of themselves as subject to fate and the gods, the caprice of the gods, as the Romans or the Greeks used to do. We have a different model of conscious development. We have a different framework. We live in a different story, and that changes over time. Anyway. It'd be really interesting to listen to and discuss the kind of storytelling that people are engaged with in their community media practice. If you want to come on to the discussion, as I said earlier, go to decentres.co.uk. There's a link there for Patreon. If you want to go direct to Patreon, it's patreon.com/decenteredmedia. You can follow the stuff we do on Twitter and Instagram at decenteredmedia. And I'm hoping to get some more podcasts. I haven't done any for a while, and I kind of start to feel the itch again to get some podcasts. So I really appreciate some ideas coming through. And if anybody wants to take part in a conversation which we can capture and share as well, that would be ideal. But until Thursday, when I hopefully see you then, have fun. Visit decentered.co.uk or follow us on Instagram and Twitter at decentered media.